learning blockchain with Ruby. And I'm just I just have a few disclaimers before I continue. So definitely I'm not an expert in blockchain or cryptocurrency. I will be wrong about a lot of things. This is definitely still a work in progress. And I would not give you any career advice. Not at this stage anyways. I think the price is quite low right now, right? So maybe buy? I don't know. The whole study, I based it upon a few documentation. The most important one being the white paper for Bitcoin, which is written by Satoshi Nakamoto. And you can find this on the web. Of course, Wikipedia, and another one is .com, which I almost I took a lot of ideas of implementation from there as well. It's written in Python by Julian R. You can also Google that. So basically, why is it not quite? It should be changed to blockchain. cryptocurrency slash blockchain is basically a PPP cash system, electronic cash system, obviously. It uses something called a distributed ledger, and it uses two significant technologies, I would say. One is basically called the digital signatures, another one is called the proof of work. So both of these things are the core elements of what makes a cryptocurrency or blockchain work, mainly just to make it fault tolerant and basically and you can't what's the word for it? Immutable. So basically these are the two things that I will be focusing on today. And these are some just some basic motivations of why initially cryptocurrencies basically introduced is because of this problem with the middleman being, say, like for example, Visa or being banks, being the person in the middle who's always handling the transaction between person A and person B who's trying to send money to each other electronically. So the idea is that the problem is that because these kind of institutions applies a cost, and the cost is very high. And using something like a distributed ledger solves this problem because everyone makes sure that the ledger is legit, and therefore you don't need a middleman. So again, it's using what we call a shared ledger, which means that every one of you or anyone wants to be involved in this network of currency holds a ledger like a minimum. So you just write down who sends money to who and who receives money to who, and everyone will have the same copy, and everyone has to have the same copy. So when we talk about the digital signature part, that basically ensures that when you send money out from your wallet, you are the only person that can do that. And basically, it's basically done through a public-private key encryption, and that's just that's basically it. Another part of it is that it applies something called a timestamp server, or in this implementation, it basically is talking about the blockchain. So it basically makes sure that the transactions happen chronologically, and basically you cannot change anything that's happened before through computational proof or computational work. So I'll a little bit more on that later. And of course, with this one, with an irreversible transaction, with the proof of all this sending and receiving money that cannot be tampered with, you have a shared ledger that is very safe to be used, and obviously that becomes the whole idea of the whole backbone of a cryptocurrency. So therefore it is the middleware. So this is from the Bitcoin white paper.
It
describes the digital signature card, which is you are the only person that can spend money from your wallet. And all it does is just using private and public key encryption. So you have to use the so imagine that you are initially this is very hard to understand. It's very confusing for me. But try to start from the middle and not from the left. So imagine that you are sending the transaction in the middle signifies say for example a person that is trying to send a transaction to owner 2. So for example probably let me see how can I properly say this. So what happens is that when you send a transaction to other people, you have to create a hash from the previous transaction of your wallet plus the public key of the people that you're going to send to and sign it with your own signature, right? That's what happened, right? So if, for example, if owner, so this is a transaction.
Hello. This is a transaction that sends some money from owner 0 to owner 1. That is why owner 0 will sign the transaction with his signature with the receiver's public key, and therefore the receiver can verify that this transaction is being created by owner 0, if that makes sense. So
hello. Oh, so basically there's no so a public key, a public private key encryption, a public and private key encryption methodology basically means that when you sign something, say for example, if I sign this transaction with owner 0 signs this transaction with his private key, the signature can be verified very easily with owner 0's public key. Okay, so that's just how private public key works. I wish I had put in a diagram here, but anyway, that's just how it works. Private key obviously is something that you never expose, and public key is something that you can expose to other people, and other people will use that.
No.
So other people will use that to verify something. So imagine that I'm trying to send an encryption message to Chiang Hien. So Chiang Hien not only needs to know that nobody has tampered with the data, but also needs to know that it comes from me. So the way that it works is that I will sign this message with my private key that nobody knows, which generates a signature. And I send this signature and this message to Chiang. And then Chiang just want to check, if Chiang wants to check whether this message is legit, he only needs to verify the signature against my public key. That's just how it works. I don't know how it works internally, but mathematically it's just how it works. And that's the basis of how a transaction is being verified. And also why the wallet owner is the only person that can send out any money. The other thing about this is the timestamp server, which ensures that nobody can tamper with the past data or transactional data. So it solved this problem called the double spending problem, which means that, for example, if let's say I tamper with my ledger by I say if I have 10 coins, that I send 10 coins to this person and I can send 10 coins to that person. Nobody can tell me otherwise because there's no check and balance in between. It's not like the bank that will say that, oh, okay, you send 10, that means you don't have any money already, you cannot send another one. The only way you can do that is by, historically, obviously, you need a central system that will keep track of all the transactions that everybody uses. But of course, with a public ledger, you cannot always ensure that the ledger that you receive from other people is legit. Okay? So obviously, I can send a ledger to you that says I sent already. I can send this to another person that says I also sent this to somebody else. So nobody can prevent this from happening. So that's why we introduce this concept called the timestamp server. So this is what's happening inside one of these servers. So what happens is that you need to create a block that is generating a hash, and the hash is used to generate the next block and the hash onwards and onwards. So what happens is that if you change something in the previous block, then all the hashes will have changed. So a lot. So you can find out if something has been changed in the previous timeline. So what this is used is that if, let's say, you have already spent your money here and you try to spend your money here again, obviously it wouldn't work unless you go and change this to say some other amount. And obviously the chain will be the hash will change. So a changing hash, obviously you can change the hash, but it will need to recalculate the hash, right? So this is something that proof of work can be used to prevent these kind of tampering. So proof of work is, so to cut things short, proof of work is just computational power put in so that tampering is harder. So imagine that you need to run some computational problem solving algorithm to actually generate the block just now. So instead of just taking previous transaction and hashing it, now I need you to find a hash that satisfies a certain condition. So in blockchain, this is called this is basically using a number of zeros at the beginning of the hash. So imagine that you will need to find a hash. So basically a hash that begins with X amount of zeros, right? So you need to find a hash that takes the previous hash, the transaction, and then plus a number that satisfies this condition. Obviously, this can only happen with brute force. And coupled with this one, it takes much, much longer to recalculate the entire blockchain if, let's say, somebody's trying to recalculate the blockchain. So what happens when this is implemented in the network? When in the network, what happens is the one that needs to do a lot of recalculating is always the one that will be the slowest and will have the shorter blockchain, because it takes them longer to add on more blockchains because they need to recalculate. That's how the tampering system works. And that's how the tampering prevention works, is that all the network will only use and will only eventually use the longest blockchain, right? So I don't have time to explain everything, but that's the gist of it. Okay. Obviously there are other stuff that I'm not covering today, obviously, because there's a lot of stuff that needs to happen for this cryptocurrency whole thing, mining thing to work. Obviously there's P2P network, you know, there's how you generate consensus, how you actually basically inject coins into the circulation and stuff like that. But it's just a very basic introduction of the concepts behind. So I'm gonna show you what I built.
Is it in Ruby?
It's in Ruby. So this is Jupyter Notebook, but running a Ruby kernel. So the first thing I built was the wallet. So about this document is gonna be available online. So part of it is already online. So I'll send you guys a link afterwards in the message in the channel. But anyway, the first thing I built is the wallet. So the wallet is simply something that will let me use the private and public key encryption, because remember, whenever I want to send a transaction, I want to be able to sign a transaction. So I'm just creating something that initializes a private key using RSA 512. And I'm using the public key as the wallet address as well. As you can see here, I'm just using the public key as the address. As you can see here, this is a sample wallet that I have. This chunk of string here is my wallet's address. Obviously, the private key is saved inside the object itself. A very quick test of how this works is that I built a verifier method. So what I do here is that I just use the private key and the signature and the message. Remember, all you need to use to verify whether a message is correct is just the public key of the person that sends you the message, his signature and the message. So basically that's all it does here. So it takes in the public key, and then it creates the digest using the message, and then I just use key.verify to verify whether this message is definitely sent for this person and signed by this person. So this is how it looks in action. So for example, I generated a signature using this wallet, and the message being just the word some transaction, and I can use the pkey verifier to verify that using my public key, the signature and some address, and this verifies the truth. And obviously if something is different in this message, the signature and the public key will ensure that this is not going to pass. The second thing I built was the transaction. The transaction is simply information telling who is the sender, who is the receiver, and how much money. So I just did something like that. The source wallet, who is it sending it from, who is it sending it to. The instruction is just me being a bit anal and try to build something more complex than it should. But what it does is it tells the amount and the target, which is the sender. So this is the way that I can make a new transaction. That say, for example, I have wallet 1 and wallet 2. I want to send something, send money from wallet 0, 1 to wallet 2. I can just say transaction new for wallet 1, sends 25 coins to wallet 2. And this creates a transaction object. So remember that this is a ledger system. A ledger means that a ledger is just a list of transactions. So I'm just storing this transaction list in a global variable, just to illustrate that that's just a global pool of transactions. And what I did was I just append this transaction after it's been created to this global variable called the transaction list. Okay, now let's see. So now I've introduced the transaction. I want the wallet to be able to sign the transaction. So I made this function for the wallet to be able to sign transactions using when you pass it an instruction. So a wallet sign function that will just create the signature and the hash for a given transaction. And this is it. And I made some changes to the transaction so that it stores the signature as well.
Can you store?
Yep.
Okay,
the last one. Oh yeah, because the transaction will need to you need to use the last transaction of the wallet as part of the hash. Okay. So that's just how I write the documentation. That's just how I use it. But I didn't actually dig into how it works in terms of verification, but the idea is to be able to verify down the chain of transactions that this is definitely sent from this wallet, and this is definitely sent from this wallet, and so on and so forth. So that's the use of saving using the previous transaction. Anyhow, this is how it works up to this point. So I initially created the blank global variable transaction list and created three wallets. And then basically I created four transactions. First one is from wallet 1 to wallet 2, sending 25 coins and using the wallet to sign the transaction, therefore creating the signature for that transaction. So I created four of these and I created a helper method to inspect all these transactions, and this is how it looks like, right? So you have four transactions. The first transaction is from first wallet to second wallet. The hash is this, the amount is this, blah, blah. So the next thing I did was to kind of write some verification function. And this verification function is very simple. I just verify that the transaction is signed by that wallet itself, and that's all it does. And you can see here there's a few methods. First one being verify self and ancestor. It does what it does. Says it verifies that this transaction is correct and verifies up the chain that the previous transaction is also valid. So a very crude implementation of how to find fraud. And you can do this by calling verify self and ancestors of any transaction, and it will work. So let's say, for example, if somebody is trying to alter something from this transaction somehow by giving it a different instruction, because transaction 3 is using transaction 2's hash, this will not work. And you can see that the assertion fails here, problem with ancestral transaction. Okay, and the last bit is blocks. So when before I went through the blocks, I tested out a very simple mining system. So remember the proof of work? The proof of work is the computational power, right? So this is why they call it mining. It kind of represents how a mining operation works. Mine, and then you suddenly find the thing you're looking for. And that's how it works basically. You have a loop here that takes nonce. This nonce starts from 0 and it will basically be merged with the message and use it to generate a hash. And I would have discovered the nonce if the hash begins with X amount of 0. In our case, the difficulty level will be defined will be hard coded in our case, but in real case, the difficulty level would be defined by the average moving time of how fast a block is being discovered throughout the network. So this is how they adjust the difficulty level as the of course the computational power becomes more powerful in the future. So this is a very simple miner, and just some benchmark here. I commented this out because it's very long. but yeah, for example, if this is a default level 2, so I need 2 zeros. As you can see here, there's a hash that begins with 2 0. It takes about 0.00018. And if I increase it to 4, it takes, I don't know, 2,000 times. I don't know. But this difficulty level and the time increases exponentially. So let's try to write the block. So a block is basically, if you remember the diagram earlier, is just a hash of the previous block plus the current transaction plus a nonce key that satisfies the difficulty, the satisfies the work, right? So, and this is what I did. Whenever I create a block, I will pass in a few the transactions I want to create the block with, and I would use the previous block as the last block in the blockchain, obviously. And I will just mine the transaction using the simple miner. And here is the mining operation. The message that is being mined is combination of the previous block hash plus the transaction hash, the list of transactions that I've just just joined to a long string. And I call the mining function that gives me the hash and the nonce. And after that, I add this block into the blockchain. Okay? And after that, I just written another function to inspect the blocks. So let's see how it works. Now, I've recreated 4 transactions again. I cleared the transaction list first. So now these are the transaction, 4 transactions. Now I'm starting to create a block. So the first block, I use transaction 1 and transaction 2. The second block, I use transaction 3 and transaction 4. And obviously there are 2 blocks now in the blockchain. The first block you can see here, the nonce found was 272, and the hash that's beginning with 20 is that, right? This block includes the 2 transactions in the world. And you can see that this hash is being used as the previous hash of block 2, which will be used to calculate the nonce, and obviously that creates the unbreakable chain. And then of course the nonce is found with different nonce. And that's how it works. And basically what happens after this is that this block will be distributed, will be announced to the network, and the network will pick this up and they will use it. And they will just keep track of it until they found the longest blockchain, and that would be the blockchain that they use. Okay? So whatever that's happening below here is all work in progress. So I've been just trying to see how the tempering can work. Just trying to, you know, change some variables there and try to inject it to the transaction list and see how it works. How the verify thing works, but I don't have time to go through all this, so you can take a look at what I've done so far. And I've also wanted to test how double spending actually works. And I have a question, but nobody answers me. I posted this out on Facebook and asked people to comment on my work, but nobody answers me. So I don't know why people don't just use transaction as the blockchain. Why do we need to group transactions together and then run the mining? Maybe that takes a long time to just mine each transaction. Therefore, each block usually takes, each block is kind of, it's just, usually now it's a few thousand transactions and then it's mined the whole block. I think that's the reason why I'm not completely sure. So, yes, that's all I have. and I'm super happy. Thank you.